lady who grew up among the shadows of the royal court, a princess who would have dearly loved to sit upon the throne of England, but her unique view of life and ultimate destiny was far from her elder sister. Her role became the ever-decreasing circle, one of minor importance and one that led to the realisation that a life of royal responsibility was outside her grasp. It all appeared to be emotional and at times a physical solitude that she would never be able to rescue. Join me now as we look back on the tumultuous life of Princess Margaret. And please support the channel by liking the video and subscribe for more historical stories. Since the war, Margaret had spent almost all her birthdays at Balmoral, dubbed the Dear Paradise by Queen Victoria. Margaret came into the world at 22 minutes past 9 in the evening at Glamis, the tragic scene of Duncan's murder in Macbeth. With dark hair and blue eyes, she was said to have taken after her father, Bertie, the Duke of York, who had married the lady, Elizabeth Bowes Lyon. Margaret Rose was 4 years younger than her sister Elizabeth, and although the Yorks were close to the throne, they were never groomed for power and had little inclination at the time to move in that direction. However, due to momentous events, when the King died in 1936 and the Prince of Wales became King Edward VIII, a problem arose when a woman called Mrs. Simpson loomed ever more prominent. The King's infatuation with this new woman in his life caused a crisis so explosive it would end up with his abdication. It was pretty unbelievable that Bertie would have to step up. Accepting the heavy burden, the family moved swiftly to Buckingham Palace. Elizabeth would begin her grooming to one day become queen. As for Margaret, she said privately, "Now that Papa is king, I am nothing." Margaret entranced her father, unlike Elizabeth, who showed signs of duty and devotion even at this early stage. Margaret's pranks and sense of fun appealed to many, and the lighter side of her nature would soothe and entertain those held in the everyday tedious nature of the court. The sisters were on different courses, although together they were just like any other. Elizabeth was possibly the easiest to handle, whereas Margaret had her own thought process about discipline. Elizabeth teased Margaret when swimming, saying to her, "You look like an aeroplane about to conk out." But overall, they had very different styles of childhood. As time passed, Elizabeth noticed boys. One in particular was Prince Philip of Greece. He was 5 years older than Elizabeth, but she never took her eyes off him after that first encounter. The gap between the two princesses widened. Elizabeth was now of age and her thoughts more mature. Margaret was still at that awkward age, neither a child nor grown up, and her position seemed far more complex. When Peter Townsend arrived on the scene, it became a moment when Margaret seemed to be drawn into new feelings. He had been brought to the King's attention and initially placed as equerry for an initial three-month period. At the time, the King didn't realise Margaret's growing feelings towards Townsend, but he sensed her loneliness since her youthful sister's marriage. Margaret, however, was falling in love. And although he wasn't the only man in her life at this time, but without doubt, he was the oldest, with nearly 16 years separating the couple. The King pushed gently for other wealthy suitors, but Margaret stood her ground. The press were robbed of gossip about Elizabeth, but upped their game and quickly latched onto the new story relating to the newly formed Margaret set. Margaret enjoyed the social lifestyle. She was in her element, and a reputation for vivacity and wit preceded her. Her associations were just as glamorous, and this group would often be seen and featured at balls and nightclubs. The press had a field day, conjuring up stories of how and if Margaret was courting a certain someone, but it was more conjecture than anything solid. Margaret had few limits on what she could do and where she could go. She was indulged and led an increasingly spoiled life. It was hoped that Margaret would one day marry an aristocrat, a suitable figure to which she could devote her life to children and family. But as time passed, neither the King nor Queen saw any curtailment in Margaret's youthful urges. Elizabeth had given birth to a son, making Margaret's claim to succession even more aimless. Her goal now was simply to enjoy her life. She quickly became a member of clubs in London, 400 being her main evening out. And although she lived in a rarefied state of privilege, Margaret was in fact sophisticated beyond her years, and although volatile, she was generous in her praise and appreciation of the less fortunate. Townsend, who was now no longer in love with his wife, said of Margaret, "What ultimately made her so attractive and lovable was behind the dazzling facade, her self-assurance and a rare softness and sincerity." But Townsend needed to remove himself from his marriage if anything was to become of himself and the princess. The cards were on the table, and consent would now be required from her sister and queen, Elizabeth. The long-time friendship of Peter and Margaret had started some 9 years earlier, when she had grown from a schoolgirl into a young woman whose beauty, charm, and talent attracted many suitors and close friends. Yet none had had the impact of Peter, a man on whom Margaret had clearly made up her mind, and what came next would be her destiny. But Margaret and Peter struggled. Although they had given some notice that a wedding would occur, it always seemed to be put off by the powers that be. Margaret said if she had known that a further year would have to pass before the two could become one, she would have called the whole thing off and moved on. Yet they both patiently waited, only to discover that the whole process was hopeless. Margaret said, "It seems frightfully stupid to have gone all this time, but it was also wicked to have given us false hopes." Prince Philip said to Margaret on Peter's demise, "Don't worry, it will be all right. He was on our side, a real chum." But distraught by all this, Margaret couldn't let go and remained in contact by phone or letter and became reliant on her women friends for news. But as time passed, the Peter Townsend drama was slowly dying down. The Margaret set included a newly acquired friend, Charmaine Douglas, the daughter of the American ambassador, and a jet-setting party girl. The royal family aides believed it was safer for the princess to indulge in a relationship with a woman rather than risk being with a man, and maybe she was just the sort of person Margaret now needed to boost her spirits. With the agony of her separation, it was in 1954 that Margaret started to show another side, one the public had not seen before, but one that made her defiant around many onlookers. Smoking was considered a dull pastime and considered quite tactless, yet her tortoiseshell holder soon became her trademark. She continued to be the centre of attention. Parties, dances, and weekends away were the norm. She'd still managed to bring along some old flames as escorts and kept her set together with events at some of the best London nightclubs. If she missed Townsend, it wasn't shown now. That part of her life had been securely locked away, in which possibly only two people had the keys. But Townsend didn't go away. Speculation was again on the rise, and the press of the day were getting ready with what they thought was a breaking news story. The Daily Mirror showed a photo of Margaret's left hand with the headline, "No ring yet." The only problem for Margaret was if she married Townsend, she might have to leave the line of succession. Only the Queen could amend the current state of events, and especially the Act of 1772, allowing for such a union. The whole saga caused so much fuss, it was decided the couple would not marry. Margaret said it may have been possible for her to have a civil wedding, but mindful of the church's teachings, I have reached this final decision alone. Margaret's matrimonial cupboard was laid bare, long gone were the suitors and once a part of her set. Single life was becoming a real possibility, so how could the princess find true love? The late 50s saw many changes. Musically, Margaret was an avid collector of records. She had moved with the times and took solace from her music. Her royal duties also continued, giving her a brief respite from the mundane world of Clarence House. In 1958, Margaret met another man at a small dinner party in London, held by Lady Elizabeth Cavendish at her Chelsea home. Anthony Armstrong-Jones had graduated from taking party pictures to ones for the likes of Tatler magazine and specialised in theatre photography. For Margaret, she was immediately struck by this man's playful smile. But Margaret began to learn more. She knew she was only 5 months younger than him, and as time passed, their companionship increased. It wouldn't be long before he showed her around his studio at 20 Pimlico Road. Margaret began to enjoy his company more and told friends she felt daring when with him. The couple would marry, despite reservations about Tony's suitability. However, both the Queen and Queen's mother gave their blessing. Just before Christmas, Tony gave Margaret an engagement ring, a ruby set in gold surrounded by diamonds and in the shape of a flower. Margaret's sister and mother were very aware of how Margaret's previous attempts at happiness had been snatched away. This time, they were determined not to stand in her way, as this could possibly be their last opportunity. The engagement was released to the press on the 26th of February 1960, and it came as a big surprise as Margaret had managed to conceal their plans of romance. It would be the first royal wedding to be broadcast on TV, and so at Westminster Abbey on the 6th of May, Margaret married Armstrong Jones. It was a perfect late spring day and thousands had stayed overnight to reserve the best positions along the route. Margaret travelled to the Abbey in a glass coach, and the crowds cheered every inch of the way and back to the reception at Buckingham Palace. The couple decided not to start a family immediately, although both looked forward to having children. Yet for Tony, it soon became apparent that there would be an inevitable anticlimax after the initial excitement. He once said, "I'm not a royal, I'm just married to one." Although Margaret was out and about doing the royal thing, Tony struggled to come to terms with just what was his role. This man had transcended from a top photographer to now one of royal escort. One of his friends commented he had gone through a terrible period after his immediate marriage. Margaret certainly had the upper hand, and he had literally no say and no answers. But the freshly painted walls at Kensington Palace were already starting to crack. When Margaret gave birth to her first child, David, on the 3rd of November 1961, mutterings were plentiful about what to do with Tony. Otherwise, this child would be the fifth in line to succession. However, it would also be the first born into the royal family as a commoner. Rifts reported that Margaret wanted her husband to become a duke, but in reality, she made no demands. Margaret and Tony wanted their children to reflect their birthright, but the Queen had none of it. Tony had rejected an ennoblement on his marriage, preferring to be respected in his own right and not lay himself open to accusations of social climbing. Margaret was proud of his decision, but now a baby loomed and things would have to change. There has always been speculation of splits within the royal family, newspapers and magazines providing the meat on the bones. For Margaret and Tony, the press ramped this up. News of servant problems, words the couple were hard to please, and a lifestyle of parties and galas with their well-heeled friends didn't stop the scurrilous reports from leaving their privacy. But on the 1st of May 1964, the couple had their second child, a daughter, Sarah Frances Elizabeth. And the one thing everyone agreed on about Margaret was she was, in fact, a marvellous mother. Despite having a nanny, she would attend to her children personally by changing nappies and bottles in the middle of the night. Margaret was certainly available to enjoy her children, and their love for her reflected this. The swinging 60s gained momentum and shape, and Margaret and Tony became total achievers. They were mixing with anyone and everyone who was trendy, the likes of Mary Quant, Vidal Sassoon, and they even gave role recognition to the Beatles. The couple had certainly moved with the times. Tony eventually got his push up the ladder when he was announced as the Earl of Snowdon, a title that came into being in 1961. But none of this seemed to matter anymore. Margaret saw herself as the model wife and mother, and by marrying later in life, she thought that both she and Tony would have the experience to make it work. But Tony had been difficult to live with, and as every woman knows, they all need an occasional reassurance, and more so about their attractive qualities. Although Tony seemed wrapped up in the relationship, maybe it was Margaret feeling a little on edge about where things were going. Petty and quite inane quarrels occurred. The newspapers picked up a scent of scandal, and once they collated all the clues, it seemed the couple sought a separation or even a more permanent solution. But it wasn't just Tony who seemed to be looking around. Margaret also had one or two favourites around the time. Her first extramarital affair was said to have happened in 1966 with Anthony Barton, a Bordeaux wine producer. A year later, Robin Douglas Hume became involved with the princess, and although this latest affair was said to be a mere friendship, her letters, later released, were actually intimate. Eventually, Margaret and Tony came to an arrangement that would require both their sophistication and verve if it was to work correctly, and as long as their children were not harmed or the public didn't discover their dealings. In private hours, they were free to do whatever they wanted, while keeping a united front at public appearances. Yet behind the scenes, many knew the end was indeed nigh. By the early 70s, Margaret and Tony were now miles apart. A new man called Roddy Llewellyn came into Margaret's life. He was 17 years younger than the princess, but that didn't matter, and the couple had a loving relationship. For Margaret, this new affair brought changes. She slimmed down and found a fresh zest for life, and most importantly, immersed herself in Roddy. Although Margaret seemed to be spiralling out of control, her relationships, her broken marriage, and just life in general were eating away at her. She took an overdose of sleeping tablets, and although she recovered, her distressing lifestyle continued, and happiness was now a far-off requisite to any future developments. Llewellyn was now the flavour of the month for Margaret. The couple were inseparable. In 1976, photographs emerged of the couple in Mystique. The tabloids once again had a field day, announcing her new man as a toy boy. It was enough for Llewellyn to issue a public statement apologising for any embarrassment to Her Majesty the Queen and the royal family. This did nothing for Margaret. She was chastised and described as a royal parasite and floozy. By 1976, Margaret and Tony announced their marriage had ended. 2 years later, the divorce came through. In 1978, Tony remarried, but it's said that he and Margaret remained good friends. As for Llewellyn, he would also now leave Margaret for another. We can look back on Margaret's life as one of highbrow, a woman capable of cutting remarks and a determination to enjoy life to the fullest. She never had her sister's expectations, and once the succession was removed from her grasp, she permeated into the proverbial party girl. Yet Margaret was a great mother, and she doted on her children. However, her mood swings left many divided on their opinions. Impulsive, bright, and frivolous are all words that describe a woman in the tabloids, but the public saw a much different side to what was secretly going on behind closed doors. Their marriages and affairs were part of Margaret's makeup. She aligned herself with the stars and came through the whole experience to be seen as nothing more than a royal rebel. Princess Margaret died at King Edward VII's hospital on the 9th of February 2002, aged 71. Her funeral was held on the 15th of February, the 50th anniversary of her father's death. A close friend of Margaret once said, "She wants someone to look after her, and she's confident she will find him, and this time she's going to live happily ever after, just like a princess is supposed to."